So, very special day. The Mindful Universe by Mark Westmoquette. It's absolutely fantastic to have Mark right here. He's written this wonderful, amazing book. I want to just read the first couple of lines from the book just to sort of launch our thing here. Do you ever get the feeling that something in life just isn't right? Maybe it's too hectic, painful, or dull. Whatever it is, something seems to be missing, and we feel a subtle, simmering dissatisfaction in the background. In this book, I will take you on a journey to the farthest reaches of the universe and back, on a quest to quell this dissatisfaction. And this is exactly what Mark does. Mark is an astronomer, an astrophysicist, and a Zen teacher. And this book is an amazing mix and blend of Mark's own personal journey, the science and real science, not just like pop science, and the practice, the actual means of, as it were, coming along on the journey. So I was thinking, Mark, perhaps we could talk a little bit about, where it's all come from. So if we take, the personal dimension first, I was incredibly moved to read the part where you were describing about being with your mum as she was dying. So perhaps we could jump in there and then sort of take things forward.
I was trying to find for a long time a way of bringing together the two worlds, astronomy and science and physics. And then what I've been discovering, what I've been learning, I suppose, in the Zen yoga, and then the sort of life side of things, all these major life events that I've experienced, there's no doubt that my understanding of who I am, what happens, inside, the different kinds of ways your mind tries to avoid pain and to try to move away from discomfort, and then kind of like learning how to sort of notice that suffering and be okay with that suffering and kind of allow the emotions to ride through. What I've learned in my Zen practice comes to bear very much, and I think that time with my mum was I've been practicing for 10 years, and it was like I've spoken a lot about death, at various points, and kind of explored it in Zen practice. But this was an absolute right there moment. My mum was, it was just me and my mum, and she was quite obviously in those last few hours. And in a sense, like very beautiful, very, very moving, and kind of like allowing all those emotions to just pass through and knowing it's all just okay,
So many times you've said to me that you got into science as a way of, as it were, taking a step back from life, as a way of not confronting these things. So now it doesn't get a lot more in your face than actually being with your mum at a time like this. And so obviously we're at a very different place now. So how does science look now, as it were, having come out of the end of that tunnel?
I think, absolutely. Like when I was 18, 19, 20, when I decided to go to university, a definite component of that was to try to escape, and it was to escape mum basically, and the situation of mum being in a wheelchair and struggling at home and all the emotions that were kind of around that. And I was drawn towards cold hard science, where I was able to maybe park my emotions or ignore my emotions. And part of my choice to leave astronomy, to leave astrophysics, was that I wanted to put my emotions, emotional life first. All those years I've been putting it second or ignoring it, And, you know, part of that was with Joe and with my, you know, wanting to move closer to Joe and have a relationship with her. And also then move closer to my family and reconnect, I suppose, with some of those things that have got forgotten or been hidden or repressed on things. And so I feel like in the last, you know, a few years before Mum died, things started to open up and things started to sort of settle a bit. And I was able to bring some of my understanding to that relationship. And of course that culminated in that moment of being with her on as she died. And then since then, it's been kind of looking back at the science and, you know, that this book has been wholly written here on St. Helena last year when I was, well, I guess I started not long after we arrived. And one lovely thing about the island here is that the skies are so dark. When it's clear, it's absolutely crystal, beautiful, dark, crystal clear. And it's been something of a kind of, I don't know, like a rekindling, I suppose. Wow, I look up and see, wow, look at that. That's what I was when I was a teenager, you know, and that's part of what drew me into science in the first place. So, yeah, how does science look? Well, I think that the story that I've tried to bring together in this book, you know, kind of like illustrates, I suppose, that science is not different and separate to our inner world. You know, it's one leads to the other and leads back to the first. You know, it's our world, it's our universe. Mm.
I remember in, I don't know, very early on when you started to practice Zen with me, I remember you saying to me, if the guys I work with actually lived what they know, they'd all be down here. Would you still say that now?
Yeah, I would. Yeah. I think well, I mean, I would be interested to know what people feel when they read the book about how you know, when I start to bring in, I think it's very natural, isn't it? You start to bring in some numbers, some sort of concepts and science and things, and like almost like a natural instinct is for the eyes to sort of glaze over, and so that's sort of your average person who isn't a scientist. But I think what scientists do is they kind of like normalize that glazing over, you know, so that if you glaze, you can't glaze over, you know, you're dealing with this all day. But I think it almost happens the other way around. If you look at what this means, you know, like, okay, so I'm looking at this star, it's 10 million light years away. What is that? It takes 10 million years for light to reach us. And the universe was 10 million years older when that star was when I'm looking at it. And if you just stop and think about that, it's almost like your eyes glaze over in the other way, you know, to sort of understand the humanity of this stuff, you know, what it really means in terms of our lifetimes and our human scales. So, I suppose you do that to work in it every day, but it's important to stop every now and again and just kind of, oh, wow, what does that actually mean?
Mm-hmm. But I must admit, I really enjoyed the science dimension of this because, you know, it's been one of those things where bits and pieces of science and quantum physics and what have you gets kind of hauled in the kind of the pop spirituality world. Often it's sort of... I suppose to say the least, it's a bit on the dodgy end of the spectrum. With this stuff, you know, you can really tell this is real. This is the real deal. This is real. I know you've got this gift for making it super accessible, but at the same time, it's the real thing. This is what the science end of the spectrum is looking like at the moment. So what would, say, for example, 19-year-old Mark have made of this?
Yeah. I think I would have immediately veered away from anything that talked about an inner world or contemplating the self or anything like that. I would have probably steered straight away from it. But I do remember that first, I mean, my sort of introduction to all this stuff was I went to a yoga class at the university. It was in the gym, and I'd never done really any yoga before, and I was kind of like interested in the physical aspect, but I remember her sort of talking about energy and prana and chakras and all this stuff, and I think my on the surface it was just like, wow, this is weird, you know, what is all this stuff? But I do think that over those years, it was just like a little bit, like every now and again, of something like that, you know, that sort of kept my, oh, what is this? You know, and then you sort of do a little bit of quiet meditation or the Shavasana, and then you sort of, something's different, you know, something's feeling different. Something is happening. And I don't think it was at a conscious level, but I think it was something bubbling around underneath. And so maybe if I'd read the kind of book at the age of 19, maybe I would have kind of like moved towards that world faster. I don't know. I mean, I don't know.
Now, you mentioned, I don't know, probably very recently, within the last month, that 10 years ago, when we went out to Japan together and we had a retreat out at Gyokuruji, our teacher Zen Master Shinzan's temple, that was a real turning point for you. So from my end of it, what I got out of it was I went in to see Shinzan Roshi, and he turned to me and he said in English, "Red hair, open eye." So, and obviously things were going on for you. That was very clear. So, can you sort of remember back? And you know, that was almost exactly 10 years ago, right? 10 years ago this summer, just gone. Is that right?
Yeah, all right. Yeah. I guess I met you in 2007, and I started to meditate in about 2008. Things started to sort of slowly shift. I did the yoga teacher training in 2009. I think for me that was a big, something really kind of opened up at that point. I was able to sort of connect to some emotional stuff that wasn't there before. And then I went on the retreat to Japan, and I was kind of focused on very narrow, like, okay, you asked me to work with Mu, you know. So I just remember just very much like putting everything into that kind of practice. And I was, you know, with that Mu all day, and then during the night, and then during the day. And I remember sitting there like drinking tea and just kind of really move, you know, forwards, one single mind. And you know, something happened, and then I don't know, I spoke to Shinzan, and he said something back to me, like something has shifted, and you know, you're and then you said to me, I think, you know, something's happened. And I spent some days after that going, really? Has something happened? I mean, it just feels like I just disappeared for a while, but I don't really know what it meant. And I think now I understand that some people have a kind of like sharp moment of awakening. Some people cry, some people laugh, some people have a more kind of fizzling, slower burning kind of like period. And I feel like that was probably me. Like I had a long, like a day or two of kind of like finding that out, you know, becoming Mu, becoming one. And then it took me a long while to kind of integrate, understand what had happened in that. Mm.
So that particular retreat, he wasn't doing formal sanzen. You had to go and find him wherever he was. Isn't that right?
That's right. How did that play out?
So
it was that day. I remember I said, maybe I said to you, oh, I think I need to talk to Shinzan. And he said, oh, he's up the back. So I went round the back of the temple. I remember walking up the back, up, climbing up, and he was in the bushes with a scythe or something like that, or a big knife or something, cutting and clearing stuff. And I remember standing at the bottom of a bank. He was at the top of a bank, buried in all this stuff he was cutting. And he's like, and I just sort of shouted up to him, and we had a conversation like that.
Do you remember what he said?
No, I don't remember what he said. I think it was something like, I don't know, I think I said there was a period where I feel like I've just disappeared. I don't really remember what he said in response, to be honest. I'm sorry.
I mean, from the outside, there was definitely one Mark went to Japan, another Mark came home sort of thing. You know, I think everybody in that particular trip could very, very clearly sense that. So back to the book, perhaps you could sort of talk us through the architecture of the book, the sort of the arc.
Yeah, so maybe we could take one of the chapters as an example, you know, how we can go on this inner journey and end up in the universe. So like, for example, chapter two is about having our feet on the earth, which, I mean, so the sort of mindfulness aspect of that is really how we can bring our mind to our body and allow our body to become aware to our mind. So kind of like bringing that sense of togetherness, integration, awareness of the body, and then kind of awareness of how the body sits on the ground and is resting on the ground. And you know, our anxiety and our busyness and things can often lift us up out of that sense of groundedness, and we can be kind of like up here a bit. So kind of like just dropping back down, noticing our body on the ground, feeling more grounded. And as we drop our attention down through the body, into the chair, into the floor, then we encounter the earth, you know, what we're resting on. And then as we drop down to the earth, we find below it the rocks, and you know, the rocks are ancient, and they're like billions of years old, and the rocks are all part of this enormous planet that we're on here, the planet spinning, also ancient, you know, and part of this solar system, very much connected and integrated into this kind of dance of planets and the sun, and then how that all came into being, you know, that's all part of us. You know, as we drop our attention down and notice the ground, it's like we're becoming part of this formation of the unit of the solar system. 5 billion years ago, the sun, you know, and how that came into being. And of course, then we start to maybe expand out, and from our attention in our body, resting on the chair and noticing the earth and the planet, we can perhaps start to contemplate that there are other planets, you know, around other stars, and what people call exoplanets, and the fact that there may even be life on some of these planets, we just don't know. And that's all from us just sitting here, letting our attention drop down and feeling the earth underneath us. So in that sense, that's the sort of an example of one of those, you know, arcs, as you ask, yeah.
So we have Mark's own journey, we have the science, and then we also have a bunch of practices. You're invited to come along too on this journey around the universe. And these are really beautiful mindfulness practices. My favorite one is called Melting into the Universe. And I wondered if you'd be up for sort of guiding us through that a little bit, Mark, so people get a flavor of what's in store for them when they get the book.
I wanted to make sure the book is about mindfulness, And it's about how mind, how we, when we start examining our experience can lead us towards these different subjects in the universe, right? Or the world, the planet, the solar system, the galaxy, that kind of thing. And so, you know, we start from our own experience and then we kind of venture out, you know, from there into our wider, like how we perceive and how we interact, how we are in this wider world. Yeah. And so this last chapter is about the journey of it's kind of like we're looking at the journey, the ox herding journey, and then how it mirrors how people found what people found in quantum mechanics, you know, in the journey that the sort of evolution of quantum mechanics, the sort of duality to non-dual use of language, the way that things aren't the way that we think they are, you know, our perception is kind of limited, you know, and then eventually, you know, kind of allowing that to inform, okay, so how do we then understand that? How do we then integrate that into our experience? And this last meditation is very much about that, you know, how we can work with that aspect. So maybe if you just take a moment to settle your body, you know, into a comfortable, upright, relaxed posture. Something easy, you know, on a chair or something. And then just beginning to direct your attention inwards, you know, softening face, shoulders, softening your belly, noticing the weight of your body on the floor, on the seat. Checking in with your breathing. And if your mind seems busy, if you've got lots of thoughts, then no worries. Just starting off, seeing if you can really focus on your breath. Let the thoughts come and go. So once you've established and settled your attention on your breath, just allowing your focus to broaden a little bit. So letting go of any conscious directing of your attention. So if attention on the breath is like walking rhythmically, step after step along a cliff top path, then letting go of this focus is a bit like an eagle spreading its wings, stepping off the cliff and soaring out over the ocean. And in this vast, this open awareness, then we can just allow absolutely anything to arise, to be seen, to dissolve when it's ready. And the only thing the eagle needs to do to keep soaring is to maintain its outstretched wings. So all you need to do is maintain an openness and a willingness to acknowledge just whatever you notice. Yeah, you might notice the breath, you might notice other sensations and feelings, but we're not consciously angling our attention towards them. You might notice thoughts, memories, sounds, twitches, any manner of phenomena, just giving them all space. And any time you find yourself actively thinking about something, just letting that thought train dissolve and allowing your attention once more to become broad and open. So in this practice, just allowing yourself to become fully immersed in being, in the experience of being right now. Enjoying the natural unfolding moment to moment. And like this, we can allow ourselves to effortlessly and fully melt into this universe. So as you come to the end of this practice, just gently becoming aware of the edges of your body, taking a nice deep breath and letting your eyes lift.
Beautiful, thank you so much, wonderful. So this is it's an extraordinarily rich book. There's so much in here. I'm sure it's going to really help a lot of people. Now, you've actually got other book projects on the go as well. Please get this book. Get this book, eat this book. But then what else have people got to look forward to?
This year, since New Year, really, I've spent the whole year focusing my attention much more on more of a Zen topic, I suppose, one particular aspect of Zen, and that's really how to apply Zen and the teaching of Zen and mindfulness to dealing with difficult people, dealing with the sort of sharp end of the spectrum, those people that really you find irritating and kind of grating on you and getting your back up kind of thing. And so we've got this book is coming together now. Actually, I've got a publishing contract and it's going to be out sometime next year, fingers crossed. So kind of like looking at how we can allow those people that really grate up against us to teach us about how we are and why this irritation is arising, what we can do this irritation, and how we can learn to respond a little bit more wisely in that sense.
So important. So people can get their relationship with the universe squared up with this one, and then get their relationship with other people squared up with the next one, eh?
Yep, that's right.
Amazing, amazing. So I'm aware we don't have so much time. You finish this one off, you bring it together with a kind of a beautiful poem, really. They're kind of a summation or a crystallization of the book. And maybe that would be a beautiful way to finish this.
So the poem that you mention, I mean, it's kind of comes up every now and again in our Zen training, you know, in the koan practice. Maybe I've come across it like here and there. And it was written in the 6th century. And obviously the understanding about the cosmos and things was a whole different on a different level. But nevertheless, you know, once we've made our journey throughout the outer reaches of the universe in our inner selves and how they correspond and connect, and I think there's a deep kind of like shared experience of being in this universe which people have had, you know, back in the Stone Age way through to present day and probably way into the future, which I think this poem very much encapsulates here. So, you know, this is the Faith in Mind poem. So I think it's kind of at the end, really. So, emptiness here, emptiness there, but the infinite universe stands always before your eyes. Infinitely large and infinitely small, no difference, for definitions have vanished and no boundaries are seen. So too with being and non-being. Don't waste time in doubts and arguments that have nothing to do with this. One thing, all things. Move among and intermingle without distinction. To live in this realization is to be without anxiety about non-perfection. To live in this faith is the road to non-duality, because the non-dual is one with the trusting mind. Words. The way is beyond language. For in it, there is no yesterday, no tomorrow, no today.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. So, the Mindful Universe, recommended. Thanks so much, Mark.